Good morning, everybody. Welcome to another Bookmaker video. Today I'm going to talk about a book called Percy Jackson's Greek Heroes. As some of you will know, I made a video earlier about a similar book called Percy Jackson's Greek Gods. So I recommend that you go watch that video before you watch this one. Now let's start talking about the heroes. The narrator of this book is actually, as I said before, Percy Jackson, and he is a 15-year-old demigod, and he is the narrator of this whole series. I actually made some videos about his books, and I hope you'll check those videos out. But anyways, he tells us that he is named after our first hero in this book, and his name is Perseus. We start off the story of Perseus in the Greek city of Argos, which is ruled by the king Acrisius. Acrisius actually does not have any sons, but he does have a daughter named Danae. Having no sons back then in Greece was a very big problem, because he did not have anyone to carry on the family name. So then King Acrisius decides that he will go to the Oracle of Delphi so that she will tell him a prophecy. The Oracle of Delphi tells him that he will have no sons of his own, but his daughter will actually have a son that will actually kill him. If you are wondering why King Acrisius didn't just kill his daughter, it was because the Greek gods heavily punished anyone who killed their family members. So King Acrisius decided that he would just imprison his daughter. When the god Zeus heard about this, he decided that he will save Danae, so he took her away to an island where he married her. But after Danae gave birth to the demigod Perseus, Zeus decided that he will actually leave. After that, when a nearby fisherman saw Danae, he decided that he will take her to the king of that island. When the king saw Danae, he asked her about her story, and she told him that she was actually the princess of the kingdom of Argos, which was back then a very strong kingdom. The king thought that if he married Danae and made an alliance with the kingdom of Argos, that his city would become much stronger. But back then, the only problem was Perseus, so he got rid of him by making him go away and get educated in the temple of the goddess Athena. 15 years later, after Perseus came back from the temple of Athena, he found out that during these past 15 years, the king has been constantly trying to marry Danae. But after Perseus came back, things have gotten much easier for Danae, but much harder for the king. Since every time he tried to propose to Danae, Perseus stopped him. So the king thought that he had to get rid of Perseus once and for all. So the king decided that he will throw a big party, and there he will challenge Perseus in front of all of the guests. The challenge worked so well because Perseus is poor, but he had a hot head, and he is brave and strong. So he usually accepted every challenge that came to him. So the king made him promise on the river Styx, which was a promise that you could not back out of or you will die, basically. He challenged him that Perseus will have to kill Medusa. While Perseus is packing up, he does not know where he will go or how he will kill Athena. But then the god Hermes comes and gives him a gift of flying shoes, which will help him travel much easier. After that, the goddess of wisdom Athena comes and tells Perseus that he has to go to the Grey Sisters, and that they will tell him where to go to find Medusa. She also tells him that after that, he will have to go to a nearby tree where he will get his sword and his shield, and that he does not have to look at Medusa, but he will have to look in the reflection of the shield, or he will get turned into stone. After that, when Perseus goes to the Grey Sisters, he finds out that there are actually three sisters that share one eye and one tooth. So he actually tricks them by taking their eye and threatening to throw them in the water if they do not tell him where Medusa is. They get scared and tell him where Medusa is, but he still throws the eye in the water because he says that he is afraid that they will come and kill him. After that, he goes to the tree and takes his sword and shield, and then goes to kill Medusa. There he finds her asleep and actually kills her in her sleep, then puts her head carefully in the bag. When Perseus comes back to the kingdom, he tells Danae and the kind fisherman to close their eyes, but then takes out the head of Medusa and freezes everyone looking, including the king. After that, we skip a couple of years. Now Perseus and Danae are back in the kingdom of Argos. When the king Acrisius, who is Danae's father, found out that they were coming back, he decided to run away and became a beggar. Then one day, while there was a sports competition, now the beggar Acrisius decided to watch from the sidelines while Perseus was participating in the sports. Then Perseus threw the discus, which is basically a metal disc that's very heavy, and it hit Acrisius and cut off his head. This will actually be one of the very few happy endings in this book. Didymus continued flying until he reached the kingdom of Sicily, which is ruled by the king Cocalus. Didymus made an offer with the king that the king would protect him from nearby kingdoms and Didymus would work for him. The king agreed to this offer. The king also had three daughters which were very smart, and Didymus taught them everything that they needed to know, like how to be a good ruler and mathematics, which most women did not know back then. So Psyche's father, the king, had no choice but to listen to the oracle. And after Psyche jumped off the cliff, the wind god Zephyros carried her away to a floating mansion above the clouds. When she went there, she found that there were servants especially for her, who gave her food and gave her everything that she needed. But they told her that there is one rule, that she is not allowed to see her husband, but she will meet him at night. Psyche lives happily for 2 weeks like this, without seeing her husband. But then Psyche made the mistake of asking her husband to go on Earth and visit her family. So she first goes to her parents and makes sure that they know that she is alive and makes sure that they are happy. But then she goes to visit both of her sisters, and they both get jealous when she tells them that she has married a god, because they only married kings. And then they tell her that she should break the rule and actually look at him at night. So she makes a plan that she will have a candle beside her, and when her husband is asleep, she will light it and look at him. She does do this plan, and when she lights the candle, she finds out that he is Eros, the god of love, and also the son of Aphrodite. But the problem in the plan is that while the candle was burning, a bit of wax fell off and burned right on Eros' shoulder. So he woke up and got angry and then flew away. Of course, Psyche was heartbroken and decided that she would take revenge on her sisters. So when she came down to Earth, she went to the youngest sister first and told her that Eros wanted to marry her by name. So the younger sister rode a horse, told the king that she wanted a divorce, then jumped off the cliff thinking that the winds would carry her away, but then she died. So Psyche did the same thing to the older sister, and that is how she got her revenge on both of her sisters and got rid of them. At this point, Psyche starts traveling and finds out that she is actually pregnant. While she travels around the world searching for her husband, she goes to a temple of Hera and finds out that it is neglected and dirty. So she cleans it up. Then the goddess Hera appears and thanks her for cleaning up the temple and asks her if she needs any help with anything. Psyche asks her for help for finding her husband, but then Hera tells her that she can't help in other gods' business. Then Psyche continues her travels and finds a temple of Demeter, and the same thing happens. She finds it neglected and dirty and then cleans it up. At the same time, Eros has arrived in Aphrodite's or his mother's house, and he tells her everything that happened. When she hears this, she of course gets angry, but when she sees the burn mark on his shoulder, she calls for Apollo, the god of healing. When he comes, he tries his best, but he cannot help in anything. Psyche then decides that if she goes to Aphrodite, she will know where Eros is, because she is of course his mother. She is right, because when she goes to Aphrodite, she tells her that she wants her husband back. Aphrodite then orders the guards to torture Psyche all day. At night, when Psyche is brought back to her, Aphrodite tells her that she has decided that she will set up some trials for her, and if she completes them, she will get Eros back, and if she does not, she will die. Aphrodite then shows Psyche what the first task is by taking her to the kitchen and spilling many bags of grain on the ground, such as rice, wheat, barley, etc. She told her that she has to find them all by name in 1 hour or she will die. Psyche immediately starts, but then she hears an ant talking to her. When she asks the ant what she wants, the ant asks her if she needs any help. Psyche of course says yes, and then the ant calls all of her friends and they find it all in 1 hour. Psyche of course knows that this is a gift from the goddess of agriculture, Demeter. When Aphrodite comes, she knows that it is impossible, so she asks Psyche who helped her, but she says it's not important and tells her about her second task. Aphrodite told Psyche that to complete the second task, she had to go down the hill to get some wool from the magical golden sheep, but when Psyche went there, she found out that the sheep actually are meat eaters. She found this out when a gazelle came close to the sheep and they ate it. Then Psyche became scared and wondered how she would get the wool, but then the bush she was hiding in talked to her and told her that she had to wait until the evening, where the sheep would get drowsy and then go to sleep. And after that, she would have to go to the thorn bush and all her problems would be solved. Psyche figured that this is a gift from the goddess Hera, so she listened and waited until the evening. Then she went to the thorn bush as she was told and found that the sheep had been using it as a back scratcher and that there was a lot of wool on it. She took the wool and went to Aphrodite, and Aphrodite knew that she had help. But she told her that the third task would not be so easy. And the third task was that Psyche had to get some water from a magical waterfall that flowed into the underworld. But Aphrodite told Psyche that if she tried to trick her by taking water from the bottom of the waterfall, that Aphrodite would find out. So she had to get the water from the beginning of the waterfall. But when Psyche went to complete the task, Psyche remembered that she only cleaned two temples and that no one would be able to help her. But luckily enough for her, her husband Eros had been listening to Aphrodite and Psyche talk, and he knew that Psyche could not complete the task on her own. So he asked the king of the gods, Zeus, for some help. And Zeus decided that he would send an eagle that would get the water for Psyche instead. So when the eagle went to Psyche, he told her that he was from Zeus and that he was there to help her. He took the water pot from Psyche, then filled it from the top of the waterfall. On her way to the underworld, Psyche heard an electricity tower talking to her. She knew that it was Eros disguised as a talking electricity tower, so she listened to him. He advised her that she should have a coin with her when she goes to the underworld. She should also have some large dog biscuits with her, and she should not help anyone that asks her for help. Because Psyche knew that it was Eros, she listened to him. When she reached the underworld, she paid the boatman with a coin to help her cross the river Styx. When she reached the entrance to the underworld, she gave Cerberus, the guard dog, a large biscuit because he had three heads and that distracted him. Then, when she was on her way to Persephone, when she got close, many people asked her for help, but she declined. And that is how she was able to reach Persephone. When Psyche reached Persephone, Psyche told Persephone her story, and Persephone got mad because she knew that Aphrodite wanted her to do the dirty work and kill Psyche. So she decided that she would prank Aphrodite by filling the container that Psyche brought with not beauty cream, but instead some magical powder that would make Aphrodite go to sleep for about a full day. But then she told Psyche that she should not open it and immediately give it to Aphrodite. While Psyche was on her way back, she opened the container and immediately went into a coma. This is because the magical powder was intended for a goddess, but because Psyche was immortal, the powder had a much stronger effect. Eros was very worried about his wife Psyche, so when he got intense pain in his shoulder that had not fully healed, he took this as a sign that something bad had happened to Psyche. So he went to the underworld and searched for her until he found her. Then he took her to Zeus, the king of the gods, and told him that because of her bravery and love for him, he needed to reward her. So Zeus decided that he would reward her by turning her into a goddess. Then they lived happily ever after. This is actually the second of the rare happy endings in this book, so do not expect much. Our third hero for today is Phaethon. His name literally means the shining, which makes sense since his father is the sun titan Helios. He lives on the river Nile in Egypt, and his mother is a spirit of the river Nile. He also has seven sisters. The problem with this is his seven sisters and his mother are very protective of him, and because his father left them, they are very poor. One day while Phaethon was hanging around the river, the local prince came and started bragging about his new chariot, saying that it was the most expensive one in the world. Then Phaethon got so mad that he told him that his chariot was trash compared to his father Helios's sun chariot. Then the prince told Phaethon to prove that Helios was his father. But then when Phaethon could not, he fled home crying. When he got there, he told his mother that he wanted to go meet his father. His mother asked if he was sure, and he told her yes. She told him that he had to travel 3 days to the west, and that then he would find his father's palace. When he went 3 days to the west, he did find his father's palace. And when he entered, his father Helios greeted him by telling him, "My son." This made Phaethon very happy. After a formal greeting, Helios told Phaethon that as a 16th birthday gift, he would give him any gift that he wanted in the world, and then he swore on the river Styx. This is also another bad idea, like the Oracle of Delphi, because if you swear on the river Styx, that means you have to complete your promise or you will die. And then immediately Phaethon said that he wanted to ride a sun chariot for one day. Helios immediately began to panic and started begging Phaethon to choose something else, because this is a bad idea, because Phaethon did not know how to drive the sun chariot. When Phaethon refused, Helios had no other choice but to accept. So the next day, while Phaethon was driving the sun chariot, he made the four magical horses that were pulling it go maximum speed, which was a mistake. Another thing he did was, when he noticed that no one would notice him driving the sun chariot, he decided that he would get closer so that they would recognize him. When he got closer to the Nile, it started to boil and everyone started to get sunburned, and then the wooden houses started to burn. After that, when the god Zeus started getting prayers, he shot Phaethon with an electric bolt and killed him immediately. When Phaethon refused, Helios had no other choice but to accept that his son would ride the sun chariot. The sun chariot was actually pulled by four giant horses. The next day, while Phaethon was driving the sun chariot, he made the horses go at full speed, which was a mistake because he could not control them, and it also meant that they go by much faster. Another mistake that he did was, when he thought about it, no one would recognize him and notice him while he was driving the sun chariot. So he decided that he would go down closer to the ground so that they would notice him and know that he is the son of Helios. When he got closer to the Nile, it started to boil, people started to get sunburned, and the houses started to go on fire. Then people started praying for Zeus to end this. So when he heard their prayers, he decided that he would have to get rid of Phaethon. So he took a lightning bolt and hit him with it, which immediately killed him and knocked him out of the chariot. Then the horses continued their path back home to the Helios' palace, and then Phaethon's body fell into a swamp, where it did not decompose but started sending out poisonous gases. When Phaethon did not return, his seven sisters, the seven Heliades, started searching for him. When they found him in the swamp, they started crying until they turned into trees. Now we are not going to talk about any hero, we are actually going to talk about a tribe. It's called the Amazon tribe, and it's one of the most famous tribes in the world because it is one of the only tribes in the history to be an all-female tribe. So now how it all started, we have to look at the life of a woman back in ancient Greece. Back then, women had basically no rights. They could not vote, they could not go to the market, and most importantly, they could not choose who they married. In the beginning of a woman's life, before she got married, her father made all of her big decisions, such as who she marries. He chooses based on who gives him the biggest dowry. But after the woman gets married, her husband makes all of her big decisions, just like her father. So the story of the Amazon starts with this woman, Otrera. Otrera's life back in ancient Greece was like any other woman's life. She was married to a fat, ugly man who she did not want to marry, and also he treated her like a slave. Because she could not refuse any of his decisions, she would get killed or she would be sold as a slave. So one day she decided that she would have to defend herself and get rid of her husband. So every night she took his sword while he was asleep and practiced in the woods. Sometimes she would also practice with her bow and arrow. When she got good with it, she told all of her female friends about what she was doing, and they did the same. So one day, while her husband was treating her particularly cruelly, she killed him, and then she told all of her friends that they would have to kill their husbands. The Amazons killed almost all of the men in their tribe, but some of them were able to go and escape to the nearby kingdom. When they went, they told them that their wives had killed almost all of the men in their tribe, thinking that this kingdom was going to help them. But the men in that kingdom made fun of them and sent a weak army that was not well trained. When they went there, they thought that it was going to be an easy victory since they were women, but they were wrong and they got easily killed. After that, the Amazons launched a quick attack on that kingdom and surprisingly won. They took all of the resources there and recruited the women so that their army got stronger. And this is how the Amazon tribe got much stronger very fast. They kept conquering kingdoms, taking the resources and recruiting the women. The Amazons' first loss was when they met the god of wine, Dionysus, and his army of partiers. When they first met him, he asked them if they wanted to join his party where he was the leader, but they told him no because they were not going to follow any man, and they started a battle with him. But they didn't know that he was a god, so he started using his godly power against them. He turned some of them into grapes and then squished them, and turned some of them insane. So Otrera knew that they were going to lose, so she took all of her troops and ran away and retreated into one of their castles where they hid. And the god Dionysus got bored, so he decided that they would go party somewhere else. Any tribe or kingdom had a patron god or goddess. The Amazons had both. Their patron god was Ares, and he was the god of war. he told them that if they worship him in his shrine and sacrificed horses to him, he would help them in their wars and he would protect their kingdom and the shrine. He did help them in their wars and he protected the shrine with some magical magical flock of birds that had razor sharp feathers that they could shoot at anyone. And the Amazon patron goddess was the goddess of hunting, Artemis. They worshipped her because she did not marry anyone and because mainly they got their food from hunting. Of course, as Otreva got older, she decided to retire and had two daughters. Her oldest daughter, who became the new queen of the Amazons, was called Hippolyta, and she died in a sad way. The most famous hero of all time, Hercules, once had, who we'll talk about later, once had a quest to do the Amazons. He had to go take Hippolyta's belt. So he went and made some negotiations with Hippolyta, and there were no problems. But then the goddess Hera whispered to all of the Amazon warriors that Hercules was planning to kill Hippolyta. So they all decided to attack Hercules at once. One of the warriors decided to shoot an arrow at Hercules, but Hippolyta jumped in the way and died. Of course, Hercules took the belt and then ran away with all of his soldiers. Then her younger sister, Penthesilea, became the new queen of the Amazons. And that's all that we have to say. Our next hero that we will talk about is the ancient Greek hero, Daedalus. The ancient stories say that Daedalus was one of the most important people back then and one of the smartest, because he invented 90% of all of the inventions back then. But around his 30s, Daedalus got a cousin by the name of Perdix, and he became even more famous than Daedalus himself. So Daedalus got jealous and decided that he would trick him. He took Perdix to a cliff and then pushed him off. But immediately after he pushed him off, Daedalus started regretting it and went after, down the mountain after Perdix. And then the people heard him while he was crying and asked him what happened, and he told them that he pushed Perdix off. And then they decided that they would banish him from their city of Athens. After the Perdix incident, Daedalus felt so bad that he also wanted to jump off the cliff, but then the goddess Athena appeared and told him that she has cursed him with a long and painful life. So after that, Daedalus decided that he will go to the kingdom of Crete and ask the king Minos if he can work for him for free. The king Minos quickly agreed because he likes free work. Things go smoothly for Daedalus for the next couple of years until the Minotaur comes to the kingdom of Crete. Then Minos and Daedalus start arguing about what they should do with the Minotaur, and then Daedalus insults the king. So the king decides that he will punish Daedalus by making him build a giant maze and trapping him and the Minotaur both inside the maze, but both in separate parts. But also the king held Daedalus' son Icarus hostage, so that if Daedalus decided that he wanted to escape or did anything suspicious, his son Icarus would get killed. But Daedalus was smart, so one day while his son Icarus was visiting him, he told him that he had found a way to escape. He had made two giant sets of bronze wings that they could fly out of the cell with, because Daedalus' cell had an open roof. So they were able to escape, but only barely, because the guards almost caught them. But then while Daedalus and Icarus were flying over the open ocean, Daedalus told his son that he should not fly too close to the ocean, or his wings would get wet and he would fall. And he should not also fly too close to the sun, or the bronze would melt and then he would also fall. Icarus told his father that he knew and that everything would go fine, but then of course he did one more flip over the ocean and his wings did get wet and then he fell to his death. Daedalus tried to save his son, but he could not do anything but continue flying to the next kingdom. Daedalus continued flying until he reached the kingdom of Sicily, which is ruled by the king Cocalus. Daedalus made an offer with the king that the king would protect him from nearby kingdoms and Daedalus would work for him. The king agreed to this offer. The king also had three daughters which were very smart, and Daedalus taught them everything that they needed to know, like how to be a good ruler and mathematics, which most women did not know back then. While Daedalus was working for the king Cocalus, Minos was thinking of taking revenge. So he set up a competition where if somebody solved a certain riddle, they would get a lot of money. Minos knew that only Daedalus would be able to solve this riddle, so the kingdom that would solve it would of course have Daedalus. The riddle was that somebody had to make a hole in a shell without breaking it. Daedalus knew that it was a trap, but he still solved it by making an ant dig a hole in it by baking it with some honey. Then he told King Cocalus that he had to collect his prize money from Minos. When Minos arrived, he told King Cocalus that he should give him Daedalus, and then he would get the money and leave in peace. But if he did not give over Daedalus, that they would start a war. The king became nervous, but then his daughter told him that they had to listen to King Minos, and the king of course agreed. After that, the princesses took Minos' body and gave him back to his guards and told them that his death had been an accident. But the guards became suspicious because it looked like he was boiled in boiling water, but they decided that it was not worth it because they could not attack the fortress because they were outnumbered, and they could not wage war because they did not even like their king. So they decided that they would believe the story that his death had been an accident. After that, Daedalus went to live the rest of his life in the island of Sardinia. Our sixth and final hero for this video is the very famous hero called Theseus. He is the son of the king of the kingdom of Athens called Aegeus. The stories say while Aegeus was traveling around Greece, he went to the Oracle of Delphi to ask if he would ever get a son as his heir. The Oracle of Delphi said that if he went back to Athens and avoided women, he would get a son. So Aegeus of course listened, and on his way to Athens, he crossed by 26 different kingdoms. And each kingdom's king offered Aegeus to marry his daughter, but Aegeus refused, until he reached the kingdom that was right before Athens, which is ruled by his friend. While he was having dinner with him, Aegeus told his friend about the prophecy. And then his friend offered him to marry his daughter. But when Aegeus tried to protest because of the prophecy, his friend told him that he avoided women, but his daughter is the one who actually found him. Soon, Aethra and Aegeus got married, and a couple of days later, Aegeus took Aethra to a nearby cliff and told her that if she had a daughter, she could keep her. And then he ordered his men to dig a hole and place a shoebox that had a pair of shoes and a sword in it, and then covered it with a boulder. And then he told her that if she did have a son, she should tell him that about his father, and then send him to Aegeus in Athens. 17 years later, Aethra took Theseus to the mountain, and because Theseus is ADHD, which means attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, he could not focus on the story his mother was telling him. But he did notice that some of the soil that was under the boulder had eroded, so he pushed the boulder from the behind, and it fell down the cliff and destroyed some houses in the village. So Theseus retrieved his father's sword and a pair of shoes. The reason his father gave him a pair of shoes is because shoes were very expensive back then in ancient Greece. After that, his mother told him of two ways to get to Athens. One was an easy way with no trouble. Another one was a very long way that had hundreds of bandits and many ways to get killed. Theseus, of course, chose the harder way. And then his mother told him of six evil men that could easily kill him. But Theseus told her that she should not worry and tell him how he could defeat them. After that, Theseus went on his way and met his first evil dude, which was called Periphetes. He was a giant man who had a club, and his main job was to hit people over the head and bury them in the ground. Theseus defeated him by tricking him and taking his club, and then also hitting him over the head and burying him in the ground. After that, Theseus kept the club and went on going on his road. The next guy that Theseus met was a man named Sinis, who lived in a forest. He used to trick people by challenging them to hold down a tree. And then when they would hold it, it would send them flying. But Theseus was able to beat him. When Sinis was holding the tree, he let go, but Theseus was able to hold the tree down. Then Sinis was surprised and asked him how he did it. Theseus told him to go look at it from a certain angle. And when Theseus let go, the tree hit Sinis right in the face, and he got knocked out. After that, Theseus tied up Sinis to two trees and waited until he woke up. Then he told Sinis that if he did not hold down right now, that he would go flying. So Sinis had no choice but to hold on. Then Theseus went on his way, and 5 minutes later, he saw something flying in the air, and he knew that it was Sinis. After that, when Theseus arrived at the nearest kingdom, he saw that it was completely ruined. When he asked the villagers what happened, they told him that there was a woman and that she owned a giant man-eating pig. He told the villagers that he would go kill both of them. At this point, you probably noticed that Theseus is both smart, strong, and brave. So when he met the pig, he had a strategy. When the pig charged at him, he would jump to the side and then stab it. This is because pigs cannot charge and turn at the same time. He kept repeating this strategy until the pig became exhausted and fell down and died. After that, when the pig's owner, Freya, found out that the pig got killed, she got angry and charged at Theseus. Some similarities between Freya and her pig that were they were both fat and both of them could not turn at all. So Theseus used the same strategy and in one stab she fell dead. One time while Theseus was strolling around a cliff, he found the fourth person on our list of bandits. He was a man named Chiron, and he had an incredible aim with his guns. He told Theseus that if he cleaned his legs, which were very dirty, he would let him go because it was a sign of respect. Theseus had no choice but to agree. So when he was cleaning his legs, he felt suspicious because his back was to the ocean, and he remembered that his mother told him that Chiron had a giant turtle and that he would kick Theseus off the cliff. So Theseus was ready when he was cleaning Chiron's very dirty legs, which were smelly, had a lot of hair, and also had several types of fungus. So when Chiron tried to kick Theseus rolled to the side. And when Chiron was off balance, Theseus pushed him off the cliff. After his incident with the death pig, as it is called, Theseus moved on to a nearby kingdom called Attica. When he went there, he asked the villagers what is happening, and they told him that the king became mad and was trying to wrestle everyone, saying whoever beat him will become the next king. Theseus told the villagers that it is no problem and that he would go challenge the king. When he went there, the king told him that it is a match to the death and that he would break Theseus' back. At this point, Theseus had developed a personal philosophy when it came to his opponents. He would kill them the same way they tried to kill him. When Theseus wrestled with the king, he found out that he is really strong and that he was a big challenge. But in the end, he was able to finally break his back. When Theseus defeated him, he said that he could not be the king and asked for the wisest person in town. And they told him that there is an old man who is really wise, so he told them that he is the new king. After that, he set out on his journey, and while he was traveling, he became really tired and found a mattress store. When he went there, he found that the worker there was named Krusty. When Theseus was surprised, he asked him what his real name was, and he told him his name was Procrustes. And then he remembered the story because his mother had told him about Procrustes. He saw that there were two beds, one was really small at 4 feet, another was really big at 10 feet. Procrustes' name means the stretcher, and he is called so because if you lie down on the 10 feet bed and you are not big enough, he keeps stretching you out until you become as big as it is or until you die. And if you lie down on the small bed and you are too big for it, he will cut off your limbs. So then Theseus went back to his philosophy and was able to trick Krusty. He told him that he doubted the quality of the smaller bed, and because Krusty is a big man, he didn't think that Krusty would be able to lie on it. Krusty got offended and told him that its quality was very good, and then proceeded to lie on it. This was Theseus' chance, so he took Krusty's axe, cut off his limbs, and then killed him, and then set out on his journey to Athens. When Theseus arrived at Athens, he found out that things were really bad because of two things. The first problem was that King Aegeus had a brother named Pallas, and he had 50 sons. All of them formed gangs, which controlled most of Athens. Because the king was so weak, he could only control a little part of Athens. The second problem was King Aegeus had also found a new wife called Medea, and she was a witch. She controlled him and told him that she would give him male children, but she was only using him so that he could give her more power. And there were also another two problems with Athens. The first one was that Athens and the nearby kingdom of Crete had a rivalry. This is because King Minos' son once went to Athens to visit a sports event, but was killed by some of the Palandites. Minos, of course, got mad and launched an attack on Athens and was successful. Then he told King Aegeus that he had to send 7 of his strongest men and 7 of his strongest women each 7 years as tribute to Minos, and they would be sent into the labyrinth and usually killed by the Minotaur. The final problem was that there was a bull running around, and it was called a Marathonian bull. It kept destroying houses and killing people. The people thought that it was a curse from the gods, saying that they were very bad people, but the good thing about it was Theseus' ticket to meet his father. The bull was Theseus' ticket because he found a poster saying that whoever killed the Marathonian bull could get an audience with the king. So he thought that it was a piece of cake. When he went to search for the bull, a thunderstorm came immediately and there was lightning everywhere. So he saw that there was a hut on the beach, so he went to hide there. There he found a woman, and she told him that she was a priestess of the god, king of the god Zeus. She told him that Zeus caused this thunderstorm to stop him from killing the Marathonian bull. She told him that this was because the bull was sacred to Minos, who was, if you recall, the king of Crete, who is also Zeus's son. So if Theseus wanted to kill the bull safely, he had to sacrifice it later. Theseus told her that it was no problem, but asked her how he should sacrifice the bull. She told him how to, but told him that he could always come to her and she would sacrifice it for him. He told her that it was a piece of cake. After a day or two, he found the bull and killed it, and then went back to the woman so that she could sacrifice the bull. He found that she had died during the night, so he buried her, then sacrificed the bull himself. Then he took the bull's remaining body parts and went to Athens and told the guard that he had killed the bull and that he wanted his audience with the king. Because Medea was a witch, she knew that Theseus was the king's son. So she tricked the king by telling him that maybe Theseus was one of the Berenites and was trying to assassinate the king. So they decided that they would poison Theseus' wine. When it was time for Theseus to have dinner with the king, he knew that he could not tell the king outright that he was his son. So he told the king in a secret way. He laid out his sword on the dinner table, and when the king looked at it, he saw his mark on it. He remembered that this was the same sword he had put in the hole 17 years ago. So he knew that Theseus was his son. When Theseus was about to drink from the wine, the king hit his hand so that wine went flying, because he knew that Theseus would die from the poison. He then told the guards that they have to catch Medea because she tricked the king into killing Theseus, but he was able to save him. But then Medea was able to escape. After that, the king threw a party with Theseus because he had finally found his son. But the Berenites got news that the king had found Theseus and that this was very bad news. So then they planned to have an attack on the castle. But Theseus somehow got news about the attack a day before, and then he went out of the castle and killed all of the Berenites with no mercy. At this time, it was the end of the 7 years, and the 14 people were about to get sent to Crete as tribute. The king wanted to spare Theseus because he had just found him, but Theseus told him that it was not fair and that it was okay. Then the king told him that if he was able to make it back alive, he should make the sails of the ship purple so that he would know that he was alive. When Theseus reached Crete, he found out that things were not so easy. He found out that he had to go to the labyrinth with all of the other tributes and then kill the Minotaur, which was almost impossible, and then escape. He found out that the highest chance was of him not finding the Minotaur and then dying of thirst and hunger. But then, luckily for him, Minos' daughter Ariadne fell in love with Theseus. So she asked Daedalus, the maker of the labyrinth who we talked about earlier, to help her. He gave her a magical string that would guide Theseus to the Minotaur, but then Theseus had to do all the work himself. She thanked him and then immediately gave the string to Theseus, and on one condition, that he would marry her when they left Crete. He told her okay, and then took the string and went into the labyrinth with all of the other tributes. When he went there, he immediately told the tributes to wait there and that he would go kill the Minotaur himself. When he went there, he struggled to kill the Minotaur but was able to finish it in the end. Then he went back to call all of the other tributes and escaped from a trapdoor hidden in the room. So then Theseus took Ariadne and her sister and escaped from Crete to go back to Athens. But on the way to Athens, they stopped at an island to get some clean water, and then Theseus told Ariadne that he did not want to marry her. He then threw her off the ship. Of course, Ariadne kept weeping for many days, but then she met the god of wine, Dionysus, and he asked her what happened. She told him her story, and then Dionysus made her his immortal wife back on Olympus. After that, Theseus continued his way back to Athens, but he forgot one thing. He did not make his ship's flag purple. He instead forgot to turn it back and kept it as black. So then when the king saw the ship from far away, he felt sad because his son died, and then he jumped off the tallest tower in the kingdom. When Theseus came back, he of course was very sad for his father's death, but after some weeks of becoming the king of Athens, he married Ariadne's sister. After a few years, Theseus got bored of being the king and decided that he wanted adventure. But luckily for him, he met someone that was just as ADHD as him. They became close friends and said that their first adventure would be to kidnap the gods of the underworld, Persephone, who is also the wife of the god of the underworld, Hades. Their mission was not successful, and Hades killed Theseus' friend, but was merciful to Theseus and turned him into stone. This is would later be rescued by one of the most famous heroes ever, and but this is in part two of Percy Jackson's Greek Heroes. Okay guys, this has been it for part one of Percy Jackson's Greek Heroes. I hope you have enjoyed the video. In this video, I've talked about the first six heroes, and in the next one, we will talk about the final six. So I hope that you subscribe so that you do not miss the video. And if you have enjoyed the video, don't forget to like and share it with your friends. And if you have anything to tell me, leave it down in the comments. And goodbye.